Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Game 1 of the Fall Qualifiers. My name is Rain Day, and joining me today is Vox Tempest, and later on, Hi-Rez Pretty Hair. We've got a great game, E-LEMON-ATERS versus 12IQ, and on the left-hand side, we got Ziftor. He's running that Victor, and Sitty's going to be on Cassie. PoisenXD, member of the Twitch chat, quite frequently, he's on Grok. FlameHorizon on Androxus, and Toby5797 is going to be on Fernando. Vox, take it away for who 12IQ are bringing in.
Well, their opponents, as you said, 12IQ will have AniDan running Androxus, Mersing on pit, Flashdip running that good old Fernando. Grigor Tiger going to be playing a Kanessa here. Interesting pickup. And WeeNIs running Eevee, and this is interesting. We're not seeing an Eevee come out of E-LEMON-ATERS, and that's been a very staple pick throughout a lot of the tournament. But as Ziftor picks up first blood onto WeeNIs, it doesn't look like Eevee's going to be working out that well so far.
Well, it looks like Eevee has been a staple pick of a lot of teams, but, you know, I've seen comps that have done well without her. Obviously, she's a very strong character right now, so, you know, it's to most people's advantage to pick her up and have her in the lineup. But there are ways. If you're a really good Cassie, if you're a really good Androxus, I could see that Eevee pickup not necessarily being your number one priority. And it seems like Sitty's doing the job here. He just finished off the Androxus AniDan on the side of 12IQ, and so Team E-LEMON-ATERS looking pretty, getting a couple of points onto the board already with Toby5797 holding it down. Is that Fernando?
And it's not just the Fernando that you got to worry about when facing up against this combination. It is exactly that. It's the combination of Fernando and Grok making great use of the shield. Was Toby there trying to shield out Poison's healing totem and just stack up some capture time? But now the roles are reversed. We see Flashdip and WeeNIs on the objective. Without a Grok to be able to actually back Flashdip up, they might struggle here once that shield goes down, as they will be lacking in sustain, and that's pretty major.
Yeah, sustain is huge. There's a lot more champions, and as we talked about, in the next patch, there's going to be an even more solidified support role, so sustain will be an ever-present part of Paladins in the future. And so I think teams getting used to that, it's just a smart thing to get used to, but right now you want to win. You know that it matters if you get into that top four slot here, because the top four teams, they move into the fall champion circuit, and that is just something that you can't really take any qualms about. You can't play for the future. You got to play right now to win.
It is everything on the line from day one of these qualifiers. And as I think that was Poison going down right there, this looks like a pretty good aggressive hold on the defense. 12IQ team, despite losing that capture, just to the sustained base combination, having a Grok Fernando combination on your side lends so much to that capture objective. They are being stalled out quite successfully. We got a minute and 50 seconds left on the clock so far, but there's a lot of distance to travel. The payload barely making it out of the base so far, and in order to get through, you're gonna have to really try and get through this tanky Fernando Flashdip. And Rain, is there anything particularly that you think might be able to get through that?
Well, I think Fernando is a very strong character in defending, and obviously he's great on the objective. I just watched Ziftor, by the way, just scramble through the entire map without shooting a thing. He literally just scrambled for like 30 seconds. Had nothing to do. And I was going to say, Victor, actually, with his constant DPS, if he's picking up Wrecker, which he is going to do a good job of burning down that Fernando shield, especially with Cassie, played by Sitty, backing him up there with some extra DPS. So that is going to be the way that they primarily want to burn down the Fernando shield and just put him in an awkward situation. Force him off the objective, as you see right now with Victor, and then just say, hey, okay, you got a big health pool, but now you got no shield to protect it, and we're going to wear you down.
Well, you're saying that there's a cursed dance being traded, but it looks like actually no shots going both ways right there. Grigor Tiger sniping out FlameHorizon straight out of the air on Kanessa, and we don't usually see Kanessa in matches, especially not when Eevee is on the board. But you know, E-LEMON-ATERS not choosing to run Eevee means that Grigor Tiger has nobody who can really get up into the backline and pressure. And I'm interested to see if she really plays up. But with a 1-3 slash line so far, it doesn't look like she's having a great deal of success with this champion.
No, and Kanessa's an interesting champion. We talk about these picks, these flavor picks. Kanessa, although she's been a staple for some people, we've seen Bugsy bring Kanessa out more so than not. We've seen Lazy bring Kanessa out. She's still very much a staple pick. She works very well, but we haven't really figured out how well she worked. And like, is there a certain scenario that Kanessa is just great? Is there any scenario you believe Kanessa just excels pretty much consistently, Vox?
I would say it's a lot more map dependent with this specific champion, as you're banking on long lines of sight to be able to get a lot of the damage off. Glacier Keep, for example, has a lot of those very long linear lines of sight where you can get damage off from distance and see enemies sneaking up on you. And I think that's kind of crucial. We do have a point fight breaking out as the payload approaches conversion. Flashdip in Immortal tries to keep himself alive but does get taken down. It looks like this is going to be an early 2-point lead for the blue team, as they're going to push this one through with very little contest right now.
Like, the only one able to defend is dead now. AniDan's there. Down goes Weenals as well. Poison He's looking for more, and actually he gets the kill, and Toby as well. And so now that's going to be a defense failed on the side of 12IQ. E-LEMON-ATERS eliminating the competition. You like that one?
I certainly do indeed. Making great use of the team name there is Rain Day, but it was interesting with that particular push how for so long it appeared that Blue Team E-LEMON-ATERS was stalled out and stalled out and stalled out. But as soon as Flashdip went down for the first time, it appears that really got the ball rolling. And we just saw E-LEMON-ATERS take advantage of the momentum, keep those kills staggered, keep the kills rolling. So, you know, they were always 5 versus 4 or 5 versus 3, never 5 versus a full team of 5. And it's that kind of advantageous position which they need to maintain if they want to look to close this one out early. However, 12IQ team, they have the chance to come back. Flashdip, now having 3 burn cards online, does have veterans. So if they dip out of combat, they'll be able to heal up very quickly, possibly making up for the lack of Grok on their team with some of that out of combat sustain.
Looks like Toby's on the point, holding things down as well with Poison backing him up, just giving him that sustain that you mentioned. So powerful, especially when you have a large health pool to take advantage of it. I mean, you get value for healing up an EV to 1800 again, but you get a lot of value when you heal a Fernando up from 2000 to 6000, and that is what Poison is consistently doing. He's on an 11 streak here, and down goes Mersing at the hands of the Fernando. The fireball hasn't come out yet. He's hiding, getting his health back. But Ziftor takes down AniDan in the backside as well. Flashdip trying to make his presence known. The shield comes up on both sides. He's got a bubble around him and a shield in front of him. But that's not going to help because it gets melted. And he's forced off the point. And E-LEMON-ATERS just looking really strong right now.
Good grief. That shield went down so, so quickly there for Ziftor. And that, for Ziftor, who was melting it, Flashdip's shield going down, I should say. Ziftor and Sitty with those wreckers, as he mentioned earlier, just able to chew through everything. Do see Poison use Tempest just to clear out the objective, and a bit more of a zony ultimate there, preventing anybody from getting onto it. As the second capture of the game, the third point of the game goes to E-LEMON-ATERS in succession. They now lead 3-0.
And it's a strong showing by them as well. And it's always good to see teams take the first game and just come out with confidence, come out with a strategy, and just do it perfectly. Now, looking on the side of of 12IQ, as the Accursed Arm does come out, FlameHorizon getting the kill onto Grigatiger, what do you think their strategy was? Obviously, they have that big point sustain. They've got the Grok, they've got the Fernando. That makes a lot of sense. They've got their carries, and it's just plain and simple. Now, they don't get the sustain on the side of 12IQ. What was their strategy going into this game with this lineup?
Well, see, 12IQ, they do have the advantage of having the Pip on their team, which can provide an instant 1,000 health heal when they throw their healing potion onto a group of enemies, and can actually get a cooldown reset if they do so, utilizing the healing potion card. However, they, without the Grok on their team, I don't know, I think they were relying on the potential Eevee carry, which we've seen be so successful being run by a lot of top-tier teams recently, but WeeNIs just unable to have a massive effect in this game. They do have only one champion that they can really chase down, being Ziftor, who doesn't have a great deal of mobility, but Ziftor's back is being continually covered by the rest of the team, and I think E-LEMON-ATERS are just flat-out playing up a little bit more to cover their teammates when necessary, and we're not seeing 12IQ adapt enough to that, maybe go for some different target prioritization.
Now we talked about, that was this great point you built up, as Toby is just going lights out with these fireballs. I'm getting hyped just watching. I mean, he's hit a couple of 900 fireballs in the corner. He's surprising some people, and I'm really liking this Fernando play. But talking about Pip and Grok, these are going to be two supports. They play very differently, and though you say, yes, we have sustain on the side of Pip, it's not quite the same as Grok. It's pretty hard for a Pip to even come close to a Grok-level style of healing. And so with that, what do you think the role of Pip is going to be in the future of kind of, you know, team compositions here? Because he's not quite damage. He's not quite like a full support healing. What do you think his role is going to be?
Well, Pip has an interesting amount of 1v1 potential. He's being known as the baby buck a little bit in pubs, but when it comes to a coordinated team game, despite having the massive slow of explosive flask, he doesn't seem to really be that effective at 1v1ing against a coordinated team, because they're never true 1v1ing. It feels more it's going to be CC application with that explosive flask, but it doesn't look like Pip's going to have any chance to get that off, as the payload will roll through, and that is a 4-0 victory for E-LEMON-ATERS in the first game of the first round in the full circuit qualifiers.
What a play. What a play by, personally, just watching it, the cam, I just saw the Fernando play be so strong. And of course, Fernando is really only as strong, it seems like, as his compadres on his side. And I think that he had some very strong performances coming out from his victors, his Androxen, and of course, his Grok as well. Sitty did well also. I mean, the entire team of Eliminators really had a great performance. And of course, 12IQ just couldn't really get it together. I think the one person who did try to carry was AniDan, getting those 10 eliminations, but 15 deaths on top of that, despite the 3 solo kills. It's not going to be where you want your Androxus to be on your team. What do you think they need to do moving into this next game, Vox, to have a chance to tie it up?
Well, despite Grigger Tiger having 41,000 damage, actually the highest damage on their team, actually, by at least 3,000 by the looks of things, I feel like Kanessa sitting at 6 eliminations to 9 deaths and a highest streak of 3 just didn't really have any kind of impact on the game. You got to remember that when Grigger Tiger goes for a line of sight kill, a long line of sight on Temple Isle, they're most often going to be met by either a flanker like FlameHorizon on Androxus rolling around from the side, putting pressure on them, or potentially just shooting straight into a Fernando shield. And I do suspect that a lot of that damage does come from damage done to shields. And even if you chip through that shield, you then have to deal with the healing totem Grok, which is able to provide sustain. I'd like to see something a little bit more close range, personally. I'd like to either see mobile DPS like a Cassie or a Victor, or I'd like to see something which can really get up into the opponent's faces and maybe drop that healing totem, because we mentioned how Poison was being very effective with the healing and how Toby was shielding the healing totem. If you destroy that and it doesn't have much health indeed, then you'll actually negate all healing. You'll take away Grok's capability to heal, and that can put your team at an advantage if you're running this pip combo.
True. Let's see how they go and move this game into the second round and see if they could change things up in their dynamics for their team and hopefully for the dynamics of the result, not taking a loss and moving it into the win column to tie things up and force a game 3. We'll be back with game 2 in just a sec. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in a moment. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to game 2 of the first round here at the Paladins Fall Qualifiers. We've got Eliminators versus 12IQ again, and the Eliminators, they took the first game. 12IQ, we'll see if they can equalize in this second match. Burn cards coming up, but let's intro the teams. Ziftor on the side of Eliminators playing Victor. Sitty on Cassie. FlameHorizon on Androxus. PoisenXD on Grok, and Toby5797 on Fernando.
Their opponents, of course, our 12IQ team will have Mersing running Fernando this time, Flashdip on Ruckus, AniDan on Androxus, Grigger Tiger going to be playing Grok, and WeeNIs on Barracks. So we got a triple tank and a single support with Grok combination coming out here, relying on Flashdip playing Ruckus to bring a lot of the damage, and AniDan to be that flanker, the only mobile DPS in their team, because they're looking to get onto the point and really bunker down. Let's see how well it plays off, though, as they might fall to the triple wrecker combination coming out so far of Eliminators.
A ton of wreckers, but who's getting wrecked here? It's Ziftor. AniDan with the kill onto the Victor, and now he's got the reversal, and he's taking on Sitty as well, forcing him away from the point, and it looks like he's going to get the better of that. A double kill coming out from the side of Team 12IQ's Androxus, and he is just proven to be a desperate need for them. He needs to be performing, and that is how they do their thing. Poison on the right-hand side, though, trying to apply some pressure, and so far, this team comp seems to have worked for them, Vox.
Well, I think that the main reason it was working is because it caused a split in the team. You had half of Eliminators jump onto the objective, you had Toby and Poison get on there, but that left their backline exposed, and as a result, they were taken down one by one. A little bit surprised by AniDan, even though AniDan did fall, it looks like the capture's gonna run through Poison, able to contest momentarily, and Mersing getting poked out. This could be a retake coming through right here.
Very well could be. The Fernando goes down, and that spells trouble. Now AniDan, he's getting jumped on. Rolled on by Sitty, and the Cassie sitting pretty, looking like she's taking down the King of the Skies and trying to find a little bit of wayward damage there onto the Victor and the Grok, who are looking to aggress back, actually healing up off the totem, but the totem's gonna go down. The shield comes up from Barrick, helping his teammates, but the scout is there to reveal anybody who might be flanking. She's gonna dodge roll back and get 1400 damage onto that shield. That Ruckus emitter is going down. Flashdip, he's got nowhere to go, and it looks like Sitty's trying to get the final hit, but he won't. That's taken down by Toby as well, so the Fernando still doing the damage, and this could be a full retake, as you said, Vox, but the Tempest could make something different here in the playbooks, but no, it's going like the script says. Flashdip's gonna go down, and this is going to be a full retake on the side.
I love what we just saw there. We saw a Tempest come out of Grigger Tiger, and as soon as that we did, Poison knew they were safe, they pulled out a Tempest of their own and just went, you know what, you're gonna ult? I'm gonna ult too. You drop damage? Well, I'm gonna drop damage, and you're vulnerable in that Tempest state. So a great retake that came out of Eliminators right there, and I think it really comes down to the team comps, the reasoning behind it. We saw when you did have 12 IQ team established on a point that were very hard to get off it, and only really were able to be dethroned from there by a bit of a misplay coming out from them. But when they're not entrenched in a defensive position, you've got a Barrack who has to set up turrets and has a close range damaging blunderbuss, no longer a rifle from several patches ago, and as a result, he was really struggling to kind of make an impact on that retake there, and just didn't get back onto the objective in time and get into that established position.
Well, you know who I also found struggling, Vox, was Flashdip. Flashdip is really getting targeted by Ziftor and Sitty very, very strategically, and the wreckers that they both have just tearing through that emitter. I mean, Cassie's hitting for 1400. Victor, with his constant DPS, is just tearing through that shield. So Ruckus is not really being able to be that support tank presence that he wants to be.
It's interesting you say that, because I think that Ruckus still has a lot of potential to be a tank. He's got a high health pool right here, and even though his emitter shield is going down, he still should be able to soak a lot of damage. I think really it's the target prioritization and focus which is coming through hold. That thought that there is, that's actually a Hexafire coming out of Flashdip, but it looks like it's going to get nothing from there.
Nothing at all, and it looks like the Barrack, he's going down. Sitty getting the kills, and now Flashdip, he's finding himself alive still. The emitter comes out to save himself a bit, but Poison, he's going to take down Flashdip easily. Another death for the Ruckus on the side of 12 IQ. Griga, Tiger's the only one left, and not for long. That's a defense failed. 2 points for Eliminators.
And you say that, however, I did just see a couple of ultimates used at the end of the round, which really seemed unnecessary. Toby did use Immortal right there, combined with Poison's Tempest. Now that's an ultimate combination which we saw a lot of yesterday with the Grok Fernando really working together. However, necessary to clean up just one champion points at the end of the round, that might actually put them in a little bit of a deficit, because if 12 IQ team get established on this point again, they will have the Immortal ultimate available to them, they'll have Tempest available to them, they'll have the Mega Turret, the Lockdown ultimate from Barrack available to them, and it could give them the edge to actually hold here. But so far, Eliminators haven't dropped a single point against them so far this game, and I doubt they're willing to give it up that easily on the second round of game two.
Yeah, it could just be a moment of confidence and moment of, you know what, we'll use it to secure it, we're okay, we can win a team fight without it, we don't need to save our pennies and dimes, we feel abundant in our skill. And now it looks like there's just kind of some wayward crossfire going on. There's a lot of pressure having from the Fernando on the side of Eliminators as well. Flashdip is about to get targeted though by the Androxus. He's got a Defiance, and a nice emitter comes on. Flashdip actually advances towards him, trying to get a little bit of damage onto the Androxus, and now he's in trouble. Flashdip applying some nice pressure there, but Androxus comes back in, and Flame Horizon, he gets the kill finally onto the Ruckus, who is now 0-6, Vox. Not looking too hot.
Not really working out exactly as planned, as Mersing should fall very shortly here to the combined pressure of Androxus and Cassidy from Eliminators. That will be the full team wipe, although a little bit staggered, and this will give Eliminators the advantage as we are seeing players start to return to the fight, but it's a very much a one-by-one situation. Look at this, Flashdip diving in 1v4, completely obliterated. They need to go in as a team. They cannot rely on individual play with this team composition, but it doesn't look like they're going to get the opportunity to as the barrage comes out of Victor, and again, we're seeing Fernando. Mersing just unable to make any kind of advance towards the objective.
What I also kind of like, Vox, is the fact that Androxus is coming a little bit back into the meta. We've seen everyone always pick Eevees, and now we've seen only one team pick an Eevee. We see no Eevees in this game. What do you feel about that? You think Androxus can really take that place again, take his role back of King of the Skies in this current meta?
Well, I think Androxus still remains King of the Skies when they're facing off against champions like Drogas. He has a lot of potential as a flanker and actually has quite a lot of counter Eevee potential, being able to three-shot Eevee if he lands 3 650 damage close range shots. But a lot of players have had issues with the damage fall off at range, saying they're not as useful potentially as Victor. But with Eevee in the meta, as you said, I feel like being able to have that air control, get up into the sky and be a little bit more mobile, puts him in a better position than he has been recently. And as we see the Cursed Arm come out of AniDan, we're looking at a lot of ultimates coming out, looking to clean up the blue team and make a bit of a hold here on the defense.
And it's very lucky for AniDan, who has actually run into Ziftor, sniping him out. But the reload happens right on time, and he actually saves a life there. That's how to save a life, make sure Victor needs to reload. And there you go, you see Flashdip aggressing onto the front side. So now it looks like 12 IQ trying to stabilize. The push has been very strong so far for the boys of Eliminators. And now Flashdip finally allowing to take himself down here. Again, 0-7 it seems like. And AniDan just trying to find a rhythm, but he's getting poked out by Victor before he can even get back into the battle. And Flame Horizon killing this out. It's tough to stabilize. stabilize against this Eliminator squad. They're just going so aggressive onto every single target, and it's really paying off for them.
Well, they're going especially aggressive onto Flashdip. I like how you said took himself out, because it appears that's actually what's happening. Flashdip is being overly aggressive as Ruckus when they're playing solo, and with the team composition which we're seeing 12IQ pull out, I'd really like to see them kind of back up, let the payloads advance to this next choke point in the map, and set up a defense behind that so they have the chance to get bunkered down, get established, get a couple of turrets up and running, instead of continually running again and again conga line style into Eliminators, who are happy to pick them off one by one, and are really taking advantage of all of that pressure they've been able to provide.
You have something against the conga, Fox? You're not like dancing your question.
I have two left feet, I cannot dance to save my life, and I refuse to do that in any kind of social situation. But here we're seeing a Cursed Dom come out of the skies from AniDan, but a great Immortal from Toby will keep everybody safe the time being, and I love that interaction right there. And Grigatiger with a Tempest, is he gonna save it?
May not be the end of the day. It is, though, for Grigatiger. FlameHorizon makes sure of that. The Accursed R for him as well. He's focusing Flashdip. What's new? Flashdip goes down for the 11th time in this game. And the boys of Eliminators are looking to clean it up. They've only got one more member to take down. But he's in base, and it all is over. That's the game. Eliminators take two over 12 IQ. And that's all said and done, man. That's a very clean sweep by Eliminators there. They're going to be moving on to the second round, and a good performance by both teams. Thank you, Eliminators, and of course, my side, 12 IQ, who aren't going to be moving on, for coming out. It's great to see new teams jumping in, and Vox, talk to me about just the dynamics of that game and moving on. What do you think Eliminators can bring to the table here as they face up against their next round opponent?
So Eliminators can bring, or rather Eliminators, I should say, mispronouncing that right there, they can bring coordination, which is what we saw. We saw FlameHorizon at times overextend a little bit, but mainly it's about the core of this team being Toby and Poison for me. You've got reliable DPS coming out of Ziftor and Sitty and FlameHorizon, but if Toby and Poison can continue to play the objective as they have been, can continue to combine the Immortal and Tempest ultimates with the right timing as they have been demonstrated in the past two games, then they will put up a significant fight against their next set of foes, but they have got a bit of a monster team to face up against next. It is Burrito that they advance to face in the second round of the bracket, and if we pull the brackets up on screen, we should be able to see the updates coming through now and see who will be playing who and how the rest of the teams fared so far in the Summer Circuit Full Circuit qualifiers.
And as we wait for the brackets, there we go. We see District 69 is going to be facing off against the Art of Warfare. Fate Esports will face off against Return to Base, the members who are Skill Ganon and Unbelievable. I believe they were called Revolution. Is that what they were called? I can't actually remember. But they will be facing off against Fate. Burrito versus Eliminators. And it looks like Tilted will play against Kings of the North. And so this will be a very interesting second round. I'm not sure if we are aware of who we're going to be spectating, but I'm excited to be watching one of these games as we got a lot of high quality teams here. And this is where it's always interesting, Vox, because you want to see the upsets. You want to see, you know, obviously the higher seeded teams, you know, they look like they have the games wrapped up, but it's great to see, you know, some of these teams bring out the surprise wins and really make these early round games very challenging for those higher seeded teams.
And this is a very important round as well, of course, because the teams which advance will actually be within the top four placement. Guaranteed, if you win this second round, you'll be at least placed first to fourth. And as you said, to advance to the Champions Circuit coming up over the next 6 weeks, post the two-week open bracket qualifiers, you'll have the shot to actually qualify immediately for the Paladins Invitational Tournament at Hi-Rez Expo. So there's a lot on the line for all of these teams. They don't want to drop out now. They have to play up. They have to make their way through to at least the semifinals to be in with a shot at that Champions Circuit. So things are really going to start to heat up from this point onwards.
Everything matters more than ever. So make sure as a viewer, you keep it locked at the right place. That's twitch.tv/paladinsgame. And we'll see you in a second. We're going to figure out who we're going to be spectating for the next game. And we'll be back with some more commentary. This time, me and my boy Hi-Rez Pretty Hair will be on the mic.